Remember last week we ended with his calling of his full posse, the whole 12. And we talked about kind of where they ended up, which was kind of interesting, and what the last we know from each one, where they ended up, which was kind of neat. This week we start out, and he's Mark is starting with the crowd that's gathering back in what's considered now Jesus' home, which is actually Peter's home. And I'll just this is a test. Where was Peter's home? What city, what town, village, whatever was Peter's home? Anybody remember? So this is it is in Galilee, but Galilee is like I guess a few counties put together. But it's a specific city that he's been going back to. Remember, he was in Nazareth and basically got ran out because he wouldn't do any miracles there. Now, where did he run out and go back to where he was doing the miracles and speaking? Now, I'm going to let you guys suffer for a minute and just wait.
Now you're going to make us look. That's what you're going to do.
Make you look, that's right. I'm going to make you look in pain.
Was it Capernaum?
Yes. Yes, sir. Capernaum. Yes, sir. Give it to the man with the white beard right there, Capernaum. That was it. That was it.
He puts a lot of work into that white beard.
No, not really. I really trimmed it up a little bit.
It's good. I like it.
I like yours too. You got
I'm
a lot less gray.
working it. I'm working
Yeah. One day you might
it. All
go
I can
away.
say
Yeah.
is.
So, but remember, he was doing miracles there. The first thing that he did when he got into town was he healed Peter's mother-in-law, right? And he's been back and forth there. He'll go out and he come back, and the assumption was he went back to Nazareth, and now he's come back to Capernaum. And we're going to start here in what's called a Marconian sandwich. That's a Marconian sandwich. So he'll start a topic, and then he'll interrupt it with what seems like another topic, and then he'll end it with a similar topic to what he started with at the top. And that's called a Marconian sandwich. There are about nine Marconian sandwiches in Mark, and it's how the man writes, and it's how he communicates. And so let's look at the Marconian sandwich. And I'm going to start with Mr. Wayne, because you're immediately to my right. If you would read just verses 20 and 21, then.
Then he went home, and the crowd gathered again so that they could not even eat. That's interesting.
Go ahead and do 21.
And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, he's out of his mind.
So in 20, why do you think the crowd had followed him to his house?
Because of the great miracles and things he has done.
Absolutely, Jamal, right on target. And so maybe some of them were interested in what he was saying and what he was teaching, but when you're healing people, that draws a crowd.
And I think another reason why is that the Pharisees and the other groups had riled these people up on their side because they didn't like Jesus.
They didn't like Jesus. Yep. Yep. Very possible. Now, his family, it doesn't say that I read it wrong when I was reading it the first 20 or so times. I perceived that his family was there right then and was saying that he was crazy. But if we read it real close, his family was probably still in Nazareth. Nazareth was still spinning about being turned down and not having miracles done in Nazareth. And then they might have heard what was going on in Capernaum. But it appears to be the umpus for them going, you know what? He's crazy. Let's go get him. Because look at what it says. It says, and well, Dad, read 21 again.
And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, he is out of his mind.
All right. So Capernaum and Nazareth, from what I understand, are about 30 miles apart. So they're hearing these things. They saw it on Facebook. They see it on Twitter. Things are happening. Let's just go get him. And so they head out on the trip. That's what appears to be going on here. And notice the criticism about him. It doesn't come from the Pharisees. This criticism is coming from his own family. Likely James, who wrote the book of James, at least James. I doubt his mom was criticizing him, but because she had insight from the Holy Spirit early on in his early life and watched him grow, but she was probably still going along to go, I want to see what's happening. You know, I'm curious. But his brothers, at one point, and I can't remember, maybe you guys can help me out. There is a point in scripture, and his brothers are kind of seem irritated at him. And he's already made his announcement about being the Messiah. And they're kind of going, yeah, why don't you go to Jerusalem? Because they know that they're going to at least harass him. And they're wanting to be done with him. So, but he says, you go ahead. He kind of avoids it. But there's this tension inside the family, inside Jesus' family, that they do think he's crazy. And one fellow mentioned, who was it? I think it was R.C. Sproul, said that sooner or later, if you take your Christianity seriously, you'll likely be called crazy. So, very likely.
We've already seen how the world reacts to that already.
Mm. Yep. Yeah, a lot of the world just isn't interested in Christianity, right?
No, they're not.
Yeah. All right, 22. Let's see how far we want to go. This is kind of a long one. 22, we'll break it up though. 22 to 24. Ben, would you do 22 to 24?
Okay. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, he is possessed by Beelzebub. By the prince of demons, he casts out the demons. And he called them to him and said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand.
Hmm. And I just wanted to break that up just a second. And we'll continue. I'll have you continue to read this section, though, Ben. But Beelzebul or Beelzebub is considered the Lord of the Flies.
Right.
And notice, where did these scribes come from?
Jerusalem.
Man, they made a trip. They made a haul. So, you know, we've just in the few scriptures before, they've made a decision, we got to get rid of this guy. And they're starting to work with the Herodians, remember?
They want to get rid of him real bad.
And so they called for the big boys in Jerusalem, come out and hear this guy. see what's going on. So, Ben, continue on 25 through 27.
Okay. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. Through 27?
Yeah.
But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man, then indeed he may plunder his house.
Okay. So he's being accused of being Satan, being at least controlled by Satan, under the control of Satan. And Jesus gives him a real quick logic lesson. He said, Satan is not and cannot be against himself.
That's right.
And he also says, Jesus has entered the strong man's house, the strong man being Satan, and bound him up, at least for the moment, making him incapable of protecting his house, which made it possible for Jesus to plunder that house by saving souls and expelling demons. So clearly, Jesus is telling the scribes that they're in Satan's house and under his control, and he, being Jesus, has overpowered Satan, and the only one that can overpower Satan is God. So here comes another calling card straight to the scribes.
Yeah.
And he's telling them, I'm God.
That's quite a wake up call.
Which I'm sure.
That's pretty good.
Oh, it is. It is. And I'm sure this made them very happy. And they went out singing and rejoicing. That's a tough calling card.
That's Marconian sandwich.
Not yet. We're about to get back to the Marconian sandwich portion, though.
Right.
Hold that thought.
Okay.
I had trouble until I listened to the commentaries in this area. I had trouble grasping the house and the strong man and stuff, who's who and who's what, but it makes a lot of sense now. Who's the strong man and who's being bound?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, if it makes any matter to you, you explained it very well.
Oh, well.
Very clearly. I like that.
Well, good. I'm glad that came through clear, because sometimes I don't. So.
No, that was 2020.
Good deal. All right. This is a real tough section, and we're going to camp out here for a little bit, because I've heard controversies over this all my life, all of my reading Bible life. So, Doug, if you would read 28 through 30, and we're going to break it down.
All right. Truly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man in whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they were saying he has an unclean spirit.
All right. So we've heard about blaspheming against the Holy Spirit, and that being the unpardonable or unforgivable sin. Have you guys heard this?
Right.
And so, you know, you could end the lesson right there and go, all right, well, now you know what the unforgivable sin is. And really, that's not as clear as it probably could be. Right. Because you always think, and people struggle with this. Well, if I blasphemed against the Holy Spirit, you know, big concerns. I hear many pastors have expressed this, that people come to them, I think I've done this, you know, out of stark fear. So let's see if we can break it down a little bit. These guys, Jesus did not say that, all right, boys, you've blasphemed against the Holy Spirit, you're done. You know, he doesn't, he said they're close. close to doing it, but he doesn't say they've stepped over that edge. He didn't say they didn't, but he didn't say too late, you've already done it. Is it a serious thing? Yeah, it is definitely serious. So what is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? We have to consider this. When Jesus was on the cross, he asked his Father to forgive those who didn't know what they were doing. There were a lot of people who were doing some really bad things to Jesus, the worst of the worst, but they didn't know what they were doing. John MacArthur says it is blaspheming the Holy Spirit by saying Jesus is demonic with the full knowledge that he is of the Holy Spirit, which is kind of close to what these guys were doing. They had seen miracles, people change, demons kicked out. They heard Jesus' words, and yet they were accusing him of being under control of Satan. So Jesus was the only representation of the Holy Spirit on earth at that time. So at the very least, these guys were really close to blaspheming the Holy Spirit. R.C. Sproul says it's a verbal or written accusation after having fully known, keywords, fully known and accepted that Jesus is Lord, to accuse him of being of Satan. I'm letting that percolate just a little bit. If we look at Hebrews 6:4, and we accidentally bounced into this a few sessions ago, but I'm glad we're kind of dealing with it now. Hebrews 6:4 says, "For it is impossible in the case of those who have once been enlightened," in other words, fully knowing, "who have tested the heavenly gift and have shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tested the goodness of the word of God and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away, to restore them again to repentance, since they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding him up to contempt." Tough, tough verbiage.
Yeah, they were wanting to go back into dead works.
Yep. You know? Yep.
So that's really, you know, that's just really saying that Jesus is not good enough.
Well, that's pretty well put there, Ben. Saying that he's of Satan and not good enough.
He's not good enough. That we need something else. We need to do something else, you know.
Mike Winger, you know, one of my favorite commentaries. You still listening to Mike Winger, Andrew? Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Good stuff. Says it's the absolute denial. This is paraphrased because I couldn't catch him quick enough. Yeah, it's the absolute denial of the truth of salvation, even when undeniably presented with it.
Right.
The example of these guys is that we see a self-hardened heart, which moves you into a state that your heart is so hard, you'll never repent. Mm-hmm. And so I'm thinking of let's move the concept into what we see in the physical body, a physical analogy. So what comes to mind is someone who has anorexia, where they continue to refuse the body of its desire for food to a point that the body no longer wants it. And the view in the mirror of themselves, their body, of a diminished body, means nothing. So the truth means nothing. So there's a tipping point where logic loses its power to convince the mind of truth. And it seems to be a spiritual concept as well. Don't confuse me with the facts. My mind's made up.
Right.
And it seems to be what these boys were doing, the scribes. You know, you're messing up our world. Don't confuse me with the facts. I'm against you. Right?
Right. Right. Well, yeah, because up until Christ, they were the ones that were really drawing the glory because they were the all-knowing teachers.
Yeah.
And now somebody comes along and they're upsetting their pot. Yeah. and they're having a hard time dealing with it. So the only way that they can look at it is saying, you know, this is not going to work.
Yep. Yep. Skip Heitzik says, the role of the Spirit of Christ is to convince you that you need Jesus. If one dies resisting, he blasphemes the Holy Spirit. The Pharisees were denying the resisting the work of the Holy Spirit. So therefore, they were right there at it. You guys remember, for those that were doing the Revelation study, right at the end, in Revelation, toward the end, Revelation 16, the bowls were being poured out, the things were bad on the earth, but there was an angel that was sent to the earth to share the gospel, broadcast the gospel. It sounded like this is the way to salvation, but everything was so bad and man's mind was made up at that time. And remember what they said? They said they cursed God, and the angel was sharing the gospel, one last chance, you guys, and they were cursing God. Their mind was made up. Forget logic. Their mind was made up. So this was an ultimate blasphemy. But I'll tell you what, I mean, these are not comforting words that there is a blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. But all of the commenters, all the smarter guys said that, indicated that if anyone has concern that they've done this, they haven't done this. Because there would be no concern. There would be no logic. There would be no desire to be right with God whatsoever. That would have left, flipped off, been done. So
I agree with that.
Yeah. Yeah. So
I've heard that so many times before too.
Mm-hmm. But you know, in and I think we mentioned it here last week. I can't remember who it was. Somebody speak up and take ownership of it, but might have been you, Ben, but at least in all of this, the scribes didn't claim that Jesus was crazy, like his family.
That was, huh? Imagine that.
I mean, you got to give them credit for that, at least that. And they recognized that he could cast out demons.
Yeah. Even the demons knows who he is.
Even the demons know who he is.
Right. That's another thing. You know, reading the Bible is so much fun.
It is. When you really get into it, it really is. Yeah. All right. Jamal, we're going to have you finish us up. 31. I'm going to leave Andrew totally out tonight. 31 to 35.
And his mother and his brother came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him, and a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother, my sister, and my mother.
All right. So he's drawing in the family of God, his family, his brothers and sisters and mothers. He's drawing them in as a close family. So it's not just a group of folks. This is a family, and we take care of each other. And did he lack love for his mother and brothers? Of course not. No. But he was teaching them that the family of God is an important body, a most important body. Yeah. Well, we will jump ahead and go to 4, but I really want to take the parable of the sower in one chunk. So it's a good lesson. I'm enjoying it right now, getting into it. So that's what we've got for next week.